If you use a credit card, you're required to pay back what you borrow, but sometimes people can't or won't pay their debt. Creditors can use litigation to try to collect, or they can give up and sell the debt to a debt buyer for a fraction of what they're owed. The debt buyer then tries to collect the debt. House Bill 2664 is an attempt to address the system of debt collection. Supporters see the bill as a way to streamline the process, but opponents say it's an attack on consumer protections. The bill failed in the Senate yesterday, but today it was revived by a motion to reconsider. No word on when another vote will take place. Here in support of the bill is John Cadis, an attorney who represents the Arizona Creditor Bar Association. And opposed to the bill is Veronica Fabian, an attorney who represents consumers in debt collection cases. Good to have you both here. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Did I get that right as far as describing what these debt buyers do?
Well, you got it right, but those wouldn't be my clients. And I think that sometimes the debt buyer gets used as a red herring in these matters so that you can kind of vilify the issue. This bill only deals with cases in which people do not appear in court. So if you don't pay your credit card bill, if you get sued, if you get served, and you don't appear, all this bill does then is when you get to court, when the lawyer for the credit card company goes to court, he can get a default judgment because you failed to appear, and he can show your final bill as evidence of what is owed.
Okay.
That's all the bill does.
Is that all the bill does?
I disagree. The bill has, there is one provision that deals with default situations, but there's also a provision that allows the creditor and debt buyers, the creditor under the bill is specifically defined to, which to include debt buyers, can prove the interest rate on the contract by showing a billing statement or by showing terms and conditions. And this is not just in default situations. The bill also allows a creditor or a debt buyer to show that the consumer accepted the terms of the contract just by the use of the credit card without requiring that the consumer ever saw the terms of the credit card agreement.
Why not use that final statement as proof, as a contract, if you will, that an agreement was made?
Well, we have seen many, many mistakes in the final billing statement. For example, I represented a disabled veteran, and he was being sued for credit card debt. And the final billing statement showed all these amounts that he allegedly owed. And he was like, there's no way I owe this much. I went back through all the previous credit card statements and found out that he had been charged thousands of dollars for disability insurance when he was disabled. So he did not, that would never have been useful for him.
How do you make for these mistakes?
I would never defend a case like that. I mean, she is absolutely right. Those people should not be held liable for debts they don't owe. And specifically, it's only a two-page bill. And this is not the medical health care bill of 16,000 pages. You can read the two pages. And on line four, it specifically asserts the rights of individual consumers by saying, in no case is a credit card holder liable for any charges or interest that result from the unauthorized use of the credit card. We obviously want to protect legitimate rights.
But do mistakes happen? And when those mistakes happen, who's responsible
If a mistake happens, you call your credit card company, and they, by federal law, have to clear up the mistake. If you sue somebody and they fail to appear, that's the situation we're dealing with in this bill. But if they do appear, it says right in the bill, right here it says right in the bill that, oh, here we go, that if you end up suing in a show up for your contested case, you are perfectly capable of trying a case under current law. So Veronica would be able to show up on behalf of her clients and win that case. She would win that case every single time, whether this law passed or not.
What's wrong with that?
Well, first of all, there's already protections. There's already rules of evidence. There's rules of contract law that are in place. A judge should have the discretion to make a decision whether the evidence that they're providing is sufficient to establish the amount of the debt. Just so it's clear, I mean, the plaintiff already gets a lot of benefits when there's a default situation. The contract's deemed admitted, the breach is deemed committed. All they have to prove under the Arizona rules of evidence is the amount due under the contract. And the judge has been doing, you know, judges want to do justice, and they've been making these decisions about what's competent evidence and about the amount due for a long time, and the legislature shouldn't be telling judges what is competent evidence.
You mentioned, please.
No, the question comes down to, if somebody charges a lot on their credit card, they don't pay the bills, they get sued, they get served, and they don't show up in court, you do waive all those rights. Veronica's correct. You waive all those rights because you didn't show up. But if you do show up, we make sure in here you have all of your rights, and we reinforce them in the legislation.
So what does this bill do? What problem does this correct?
The problem is there is an inconsistency in the limited jurisdiction courts. So these are the small claims courts or the justice courts with how the damages have to be proved. If the case in controversy is only $1,000 or $1,500, and I have to put on a whole damages case, it could cost me $3,000, $4,000, or $5,000 in a case where the other side didn't even show up. And so this makes it more efficient to collect the debt to the benefit of all credit card holders.
Does this address inconsistencies as far as differing judges are concerned?
Well, it would address, well, I don't think that there's that many inconsistencies. I think the rule is pretty clear about what they need to submit. They have to submit an affidavit of someone with personal knowledge of the debt or who is actually the custodian of records for the original creditor. In this case, you know, that's the problem with the debt buyers. They don't have a custodian from the original creditor to testify as to the amount due and can't submit that affidavit. I also wanted to point out that with respect to these default judgments, it's not like everyone actually gets served with this information and has the opportunity to dispute it. The Arizona Rules of Civil Procedure allow for these people to be, the rule itself allows service not necessarily by handing it to the person, but it also allows you to just leave it at the home with someone of suitable age or discretion. There's also alternative service where people get served through publication or by mailing to the last known address. This particularly can affect military members of the military who move around a lot. These people aren't always people who get notice of the suit, and their interests should be protected in the default proceeding by a judge who has a discretion and has the legal knowledge to know what's appropriate.
And that's the current law. That's nothing in this bill changes how you have to serve somebody. And in fact, if you have to serve somebody from publication, by publication, you have to prove they're avoiding your service. So the bottom line is, if people don't pay their bills and if people don't show up for court, then the whole system, all of us have to pay this charge. All of us have to pay this cost. The consumer is the one that ultimately benefits from this bill because of making the legal system more efficient in small claims cases.
Critics say that this allows for forcing repayment of what's already been paid or what may already have been dismissed or forgiven. Is that a possibility with this bill?
No, and we specifically try to make it, we specifically say that you can't collect those kinds of cases. You have to allow the current federal law, the current state law that protects consumers right now is reinforced in language in this bill on page 2.
You agree with that?
I do not agree with that. I believe that this will continue to allow creditors to use the courts as a collection arm. You know, they already have a great deal of power because they're the ones with all the records who are able to establish their cases quite easily. You know, and again, this isn't just about default judgments. Again, there's two provisions of this bill that apply when it's a contested action. They can establish their interest rate through a billing statement or terms and conditions without any proof that the consumer ever got it. They can establish the existence of a contract just by the fact that the consumer used the credit card.
Right, so you can establish listen to her words, you can establish the existence of the contract because you're out there charging things on your credit card. Well, of course you can. If I go and buy a TV at Walmart and I put that in my house, guess what? I have to pay that back. You have to pay those things back. And if you don't, everybody pays for it in increased cost on their credit cards. The people who pay their credit cards are the ones that pay the cost of these collections not happening.
Bottom line, critics say this benefits collectors, debt buyers, if you will, not consumers. Your response?
I believe the vast number of consumers, 99% of the consumers, want to see this loophole go away because they're the ones that will benefit.
Bottom line, supporters say this makes the legal system more efficient. Your response?
My response is that supporters want to put their thumb on the scales of justice to make it easier for debt buyers to prove their case, even though their records are often mistaken.
We have to stop it right there. Good discussion. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having us.